Hi, this is Reverend Dave Johnson, and you're watching Sequentially Yours.
Welcome to Sequentially Yours, Cinematically Ours. I'm Karim.
And I'm Debbie.
And today we're going to discuss Logan. Alright, so, wow, that was an emotional gut punch, wouldn't you say?
Yeah.
Yeah, wow. This is, you know, people have been saying this is not really a part of the X-Men franchise, and I guess it isn't in the sense that it's not part of either of the continuities that we have seen in the movie so far. But that being said, this is pretty X-Men-y, at least I feel, from a comic book perspective, in the sense that it really is about fighting, it's about heroism in the face of a world that does not want you. That's really what I see in Logan, and that's as X-Men as it gets. It's a world that does not want him there, that is doing everything in its power to make him miserable if we're going to personify the world, and yet he continues on, and he continues on heroically. I think that says a lot about the character. We will have a spoiler section, but you know, first, I guess, some non-spoilery thoughts. What did you think?
Oh, I loved it. I absolutely loved it. First things first, not a kid's movie.
No.
Be very careful about taking your kids. This deserves its R rating.
Yeah.
It is very violent. There's a lot of, as they say, mature subject matter. A lot of violence, a lot of swearing.
Brief nudity.
Yeah.
Yeah, we were sitting next to a 10-year-old in the theater and somebody brought their baby to the theater?
Yeah, I don't know what's wrong with some people.
It was generally a good baby. There's just one kind of little cry at one point, but still it's like, why why do you have your baby in Logan?
Yeah.
What would possess you to bring your infant to a theater to begin with?
But you got me. I don't know. Mm. But yeah, it's very good. This is some of the best acting I've ever seen from Hugh Jackman.
Yeah.
If you've ever seen the movie Prisoners, he's at least as good as he was there. And if you haven't seen that movie, I highly recommend it. That's another tough sit, but it's worth it. It's an amazing movie. That's mm-hmm. really good.
Yeah.
But he's that good here. He's displaying incredibly subtle depths and nuance. I mean, you see it in the trailers. He's not well, I'll just say.
Yeah.
And you feel it. Every second of his performance looks painful.
And watching him and Patrick Stewart play off each other.
Yeah.
And we've seen it a little bit in the X-Men films, but here they have sort of stripped away kind of all the extraneous people, and it's just, you know, two of the finest actors I think that we have had in our lifetime. I mean, these two are just amazing actors. Throw in, like, Ian McKellen to that mix and just collect all the Oscars at that point.
Yeah.
But, yeah, that, and that's something that actually the two of us were discussing that I mentioned was that, you know, as much as I like the other X-Men movies, and I think that, you know, people like Halle Berry and James Marsden, Cyclops, and all of them, they have talent, and they are good actors, but none of them are on the level of Jackman or Stewart. And without them there, and this is going to sound mean, but I don't mean it to be mean, dragging down the scene to their level, these two just pop on screen from beginning of the movie to the last moment.
Well, and some of that is the writing has not been very good on most of the X-Men movies. I think they tended to not really know what they wanted to be, which is a little bit of a problem.
Yeah. And I think part of that is that the X-Men franchise was in that weird middle ground when superhero movies had to be purely for kids, or, you know, so far out into the realms of weirdness that they, you know, they couldn't be a serious film franchise. Yeah. And it's impossible to look at the X-Men franchise and not say that this is vitally important to the serious takes on superheroes mm-hmm. that we have now, as far as movies go, that, you know, without X-Men, we don't have an MCU.
Yeah.
That's, I don't think anybody can argue that point. Mm-mm. But, yeah, you're right. It's, you know, I can't remember who said it once, but I remember when X3 came out, which is still my least favorite of the franchise, and I will hold a grudge till the day I die.
He likes it less than X-Men Origins Wolverine.
I would rather watch Origins Wolverine in a heartbeat than X3.
Which I can't agree with that.
Yeah. See? We're different. No, seriously. I hate X3. And, you know, I remember when X3 came out and they were doing the Dark Phoenix saga. I'm like, but where's the Emkron crystal? Where's the Shi'ar? Where's, you know, all of these things that were part of the Phoenix saga, both in the comics and more at the time, more importantly to me, in the 90s cartoon, which I remembered a little bit more. And somebody pointed out that at that time, there's no way they could have introduced aliens to mainstream movies. It just wasn't going to happen.
Yeah.
Ignore that. Sorry, we have very active cats. But yeah, they you just couldn't introduce that stuff. And, you know, now we're getting to the point where you can. But even then, so much of the mythos just isn't quite working out. So you ended up with these sort of half-assed attempts at X-Men scripts, where they're trying to remake these really popular X-Men ideas, but they're trying to do it within what they think the mainstream can accept.
Yeah, and I can't really blame them for... I don't think they were particularly well executed, but I can't really blame them for what they... that they left out the aliens, because, yeah, at the time... And when did the first one come out? Was that
first one came out in 2000.
2000?
I think X3 was 2004? Something like that.
Hmm.
So, yeah, it was... I can't remember. We'll put it down here.
Yeah, I don't remember either. But, I think it was after 2005.
It could have been. I don't know. I can't read the thing that I've already edited in the bottom. Sorry. You guys know. You know this answer. We're still having this conversation.
but at the time, X-Men, the public would not have accepted aliens. That would have been seen as too silly.
Yeah, even by Avengers, the aliens were, for all intents and purposes, just goons. The fact that they were aliens was unimportant to the plot. They could have been extra-dimensional beings. They could have been an army of warriors from some place near Asgard. Hi, Sammy. Yeah, they could have been anything at that point.
Yeah.
The Chitauri, it didn't matter what the Chitauri were in Avengers.
Yeah. Yeah, so I can't blame them. And I think it was ambitious of them to try, but to try to make the X-Men movie, especially the first one.
Yeah.
At the time, but... I don't know if they could have made a good X-Men movie at that time.
No, they made the best X-Men movie they could have at the time. This was also, you know, just pre-Spider-Man, Sam Raimi's Spider-Man, which also pushed the boundaries of what you could do in superhero medium.
Yeah.
In superhero media. This was post-Blade, but Blade was only marginally a comic book movie.
Yeah.
There was nothing particularly about the comic book aspect that was important.
Sorry.
Yeah. So, Logan at this point, I think this is also a boundary changer in the sense that this is not a superhero movie, it's a Western.
Yeah.
But it is definitely a comic book movie. And I think that this is... particularly here on Sequentially Yours, you know, comics are literature, and literature can be in a variety of genres, and so can comic books. Comic books are a medium, they are not a genre. And in this case, it was nice to see somebody doing what is so great about comics, which is using the fantastical elements that you see in comic books and then transferring them to a recognizable genre. We're watching a Western, but it's a Western about a guy who has claws in his hands.
And you're saying it's a comic book movie is because it's based on a comic character?
I'm saying it's a comic book movie because it takes genre convention and adds fantastical elements in a way that feels natural. That's one thing that the reason why I believe that comic books are so good at exploring concepts is that due to the nature of the medium, the fact that it's fairly cheap, that you can kind of do whatever you want with it, and the fact that there are no restrictions to what you can do in it conceptually, comic books allow you to explore things and do little tweaks to common ideas. The movie itself makes no pretenses to not being heavily influenced by the movie Shane. In fact, the movie Shane features in this film.
Yeah.
Joey, there's no living with a killing. There's no going back from one. Right and wrong, it's a brand. A brand sticks. There's no going back. Now you run on home to your mother and tell her everything's all right. And there aren't any more guns in the valley.
And is quoted several times in this film, and is thematically super important to this film.
Yeah.
But it's, what if Shane was not just a gunslinger and a hero? What if Shane had a superpower? What if Shane was struggling with his own animalistic tendencies? And to an extent, Shane does that, but it's, you know, it's slightly different in that respect. You know, Unforgiven was mentioned by the director James Mangold?
I believe so. I think so,
James Mangold. I'll correct myself down here many, many times if I need to. You saw me do it on Doc Strange. I'll do it here, too. James Mangold had mentioned that Unforgiven was one of his inspirations for this, and The Wrestler also came up. And both Unforgiven and The Wrestler are about, you know, people who used to be great, used to be almost heroic in their own sense, and now feel abandoned by the world. And that's very much the kind of thematic stuff that's going on in Logan.
Absolutely.
I really almost want to do a regular video on Logan just because there's so much going on, but also a lot of people have beaten me to that. It is very, 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 very loosely based on Mark Millar's and Steve McNiven's Old Man Logan. And I noticed a couple of references in there. For example, at one point, Logan is illegally buying medicine off of a nurse, and that nurse has a tattoo on his arm that's the Hawkeye logo. Hawkeye was Old Man Logan, that was his road trip buddy. Also, it's a road trip movie. And also we find out at one point that the X-Men were all killed in a tragic accident involving one of the other X-Men, which I'm not going to spoil for now, but suffice it to say, though, that's reference it. But otherwise, beyond that, they're both Westerns. But mostly the big difference, I think, between them is thematically, Millar always approaches the superhero genre, with the exception of Superman, Red Sun is an exception to this, but with the exception of Superman, he always approaches the superhero genre as if heroism is not internal, as if heroism is not something that we feel and we act in such a way as to be heroes. There's always an ulterior motive, there's always some sense of these characters are only doing it because they think they should, or because everybody else is doing it, and if you get rid of, you know, this sense of hope or community or duty or anything like that, they would just revert to being selfish tools. Even Kick-Ass, which I think is probably the most apropos of that, the character is doing it primarily because he wants to feel powerful in the face of a very not powerful life. But Logan flips that. Logan, he will continually deny his own heroism. This is something that we've seen throughout the franchise. But even though he denies his heroism, it's clear that he is always experiencing it. Even when he tries not to be a hero, he is still a hero. The very premise of the film at the beginning is Professor X is starting to lose it. He has some sort of degenerative disease, maybe Alzheimer's, dementia, something along those lines. But because he is such a powerful psychic, when he has seizures, this causes everybody around him pain and could kill people. So Logan is essentially working as a limo driver to pay to illegally buy seizure medication for Xavier to try to keep him cognizant of what's going on. He's taking care of him, and just because he's not fighting bad guys does not mean that he is not being heroic in that action and in that moment.
Yeah.
Sorry. I've just been rambling. Please go throw something in here, please, before I just go on for another hour. I'll do it. I got it all. I got it in me.
Yeah, it's a very, like I said, Jackman's performance is incredibly nuanced, and I don't think it's even that he's not trying to be a hero. He doesn't think he is still a hero. Yeah. I think he views himself as a failure.
Yeah.
And it's...
It doesn't help that Xavier keeps reinforcing that.
Yeah, which should mention, this is different than you've possibly ever seen Patrick Stewart. Because he is an old man here.
And we know that Patrick Stewart doesn't actually age in real life.
Yeah, his apparent, immortality notwithstanding. He's an old man here. He seems very frail and not very with it. I mean, he definitely seems like there's dementia or Alzheimer's or something going on here. And it's still an amazingly powerful performance. And he's kind of awful to Logan and also Caliban, who's helping to take care of Professor X at the beginning. And he's awful to them. And he swears. Yeah, Patrick Stewart swears in this.
Yes. Also, Professor Xavier swears in this.
Yeah.
Neither of those men.
Thank you.
I always assumed they were too erudite for vulgar common language like ours.
Yes, and at one point he goes, at the camera, which is just hilarious. It's worth watching. I can go on and on. I won't. Should also mention that the girl who plays Laura, who's basically what kicks off the plot, really, of the movie. I don't think it's spoilering to say that she's a clone of Wolverine.
Yeah, no, that's pretty well established at this point.
And this actress, this kid, is amazing. She's
so good.
She doesn't speak except some grunts and growls for what, the first hour and a half, probably?
Like three quarters of the movie.
Yes.
She doesn't say an actual word.
And Wolverine assumes she's mute. And which you can believe. And of course turns out she's not. she has plenty to say when she does start talking. But this kid has a future because my gosh.
So good.
The performance she gives, purely physical performance she gives is so subtle and so nuanced. There's so much going on there.
Mm-hmm.
I was blown away. This is, she acts better than a lot of adults.
This she acts better than some of the adults in the film.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, this is, yeah, the movie is worth seeing for a lot of reasons, but it's worth seeing for her alone.
Yeah, I've already forgotten her name. We're going to put it here. But watch for her.
Daphne Keen?
That could be that Keen.
Something Keen. I think it's Daphne Keen.
It's still down here, so you guys can read it. Again, this is like playing one of those party games where you can see what we need to see, but we can't. We're just sitting here guessing.
The magic of editing.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Yeah, just give us a clue, please.
Also, the visuals, this feels very much, it feels very much like a Western. It's very, very stripped down, and the colors are very muted. It's a lot of wide shots of landscapes and lots of sky and making the humans feel very small.
Mm-hmm.
So it's gorgeous. This is a very gorgeous movie to look at.
Yeah.
It's very, very stripped down because it's mostly, most of the movie is those three people.
Yeah, it's a character piece. It really is a character piece. And it's, yeah, the plot is there strictly to watch them rise and fall.
Yeah.
Mostly fall.
Yeah. Yeah. And I will say, surprisingly, in spite of the fact it's a very, very grim movie, this is a very dark movie, the end was a lot more hopeful than I expected.
Yeah, we'll go into more details after the spoiler card, but yeah, we have to keep coming back to Shane on this one. It's got this bittersweet ending to it that will just, you know, it will tear at you, but it gives you a reason to believe that there's more to it.
Yeah. Yeah, it's worth seeing.
Yeah.
Go say, oh, we saw it in regular presentation, we did not see it in 3D.
Or with Dolby Sound or anything, because that's apparently a thing this time around.
Yeah.
Yeah, we just saw it in standard presentation, it was fine. Also, before we move on to spoilers in a second here, but before we do, I also want to give a shout out to X-23, Daphne Keen, whoever was, her stunt doubles. Because they were so good. I mean, we're talking just seriously fluent motions, no fear, which they would have to be little girls to be doing this.
Yeah.
And they were just really just knocking it out of the park. Mm-hmm. The action, we haven't even talked about the action sequences, but yeah, the action sequences are beautiful. There's only one that I had that I didn't think was fantastic, and there was a car chase sequence toward the beginning, and it's only because now that I've seen Mad Max Fury Road, I expect all my car chase sequences to be meticulously directed and edited, and I want my eyes to be moving where they should be and setting it all up, and instead we got a lot of really quick cuts, and I'm like, yeah, this is fine, but I think we can do better than that, don't you, Mr. Mangold?
It's still a very engaging car chase, let's be clear, the action is very, very good. It's very, very visceral and raw.
Yes.
And it's, again, this is a hard R movie. This does not shy away. There's a lot of people that get their heads taken off.
Yeah, a lot of decapitations, a lot of claws through the skull.
Yeah.
I actually got kind of tired of it toward the end. Not like a, ugh, I'm so sick of this, but more of a, okay, yeah, claws through the skull. I get it.
Which I think that would may have been part of the point.
Yeah, actually. I think so. Yeah, I can imagine that's how Logan feels about it too.
Yeah, he's clearly weary of everything, especially by the end of the movie, and I think they intend the audience to feel somewhat weary of it too.
Yeah,
but it's still beautifully choreographed. This is an excellent looking movie, very exciting. They use their action fairly sparingly. It's not, you know, action scene, action scene, action scene, action scene, 5-minute break. No, it's not that at all.
No, it's
There's what, three major action set pieces in the movie?
Yeah, I'd say three, maybe four set
maybe
pieces.
Maybe four, yeah.
If you count the hotel.
Yeah, which, yeah, that can I definitely yeah. say that
So
counts.
Four, I'd say.
So, but yeah, it's very exciting, very worth it.
Yeah.
So.
Okay, so we're moving on to spoilers now.
Spoilers!
Okay. Alright, so, let's talk about, let's start with the biggest spoiler and just get that out of the way, X-24.
Yeah.
So yeah. They have what is essentially a perfect clone of Logan as well, on top of X-23, on top of Laura.
I want to mention, Laura is never specifically referred to as X-23. It's in some paperwork.
Yeah.
But she's only called Laura in the movie.
Yeah. Yeah, he's never referred to as X-24, he's just 24 also. So I guess it could be Jack Bauer. But basically he's a younger version of Wolverine that has no personality or conscience. He is just pure rage.
Yeah.
One of the things that I noticed in the movie that I really love what they did with this is that he looks a lot like Liev Schreiber did in X-Men Origins Wolverine. Just the way they did his makeup and his beard and his hair and everything, he mm-hmm. looks like Sabretooth, which I think was a nice touch there. I kind of wish they just brought in Sabretooth, but if they're going to do this whole Logan physically fighting against this sense of himself as a monster that he always believes himself to be.
Oh, say his shadow.
Yeah, his shadow self. You know, they are not subtle about this. Logan always wears a white tank top. He's always in a black tank top.
Well, to be fair, Logan has always worn a white tank top. That's all. A white wife beater has been his thing in most of the movies.
Yeah, in fact, I think Deadpool even mentioned it in the sketch at the beginning.
Tank top and some jeans. Yeah. I think was what he said.
Something like that. But yeah, X-24 is always wearing a black tank top, which again is also a reference to Shane, where Shane wears a white hat, the bad guy
black
wears a
hat,
black
hat,
and yeah. It's, you know, it would be cliche if it weren't specifically referencing these mm-hmm. kind of classic tropes.
Yeah, yeah, yes, it's obvious, but it's used well.
Yeah, but like I said, I do like the 24 looks like Sabretooth.
Mm-hmm.
It's a nice touch.
I agree. I do have to say, who thought it was a good idea to have create something that's pure rage?
Yeah, that seems like a dumb idea.
This seems like you're creating your own destruction in doing that.
Pretty much, yeah. But then again, that's what they did with Wolverine. That's what they did with Logan too. And in this case, one of the main bad guys is a character named Xander Rice, who was created for the movie, but he is the son of, I think it was Darian Rice, who worked on the Weapon X project, and presumably Wolverine killed in Apocalypse.
According to the movie.
Yes.
According to this movie, Wolverine killed his dad.
Yes, I'm willing to bet I guess he's one of the, like, random dudes in that scene in Apocalypse.
Very possibly. Very possibly. Yeah. But what were we talking about?
We were talking about X-24.
Oh, yes, X-24. It's interesting with him as a reflection of Wolverine. It's interesting from that aspect, but he obviously is not an interesting character. He is a killing machine.
Yeah, he is no different than the equipment that they use to shoot at Wolverine uselessly.
Yeah, except he's he can hurt Wolverine.
Yes.
Which should be mentioned. It seems to be that Wolverine has adamantium poisoning. I don't know if they ever actually say that outright. It's never.
It's hinted at.
It's what he thinks
yeah.
is going on. It's what Wolverine thinks is happening with him, and. And this is what's, when I said he's not well, this is slowly, seems to be slowly killing him.
Yeah. He's got an adamantium bullet, like the ones that they had in Origins. Probably, you know, he's kept that one for this entire time. Because why not?
Which he says that he's saving for basically when he's at his lowest point.
Yeah. Which he is pretty close to almost every point in this film.
Yeah.
Whenever something good happens, it is not long before something bad follows it up.
Yeah.
You know, they seem to have, at one point they're in Vegas and they seem to be ahead of things, ahead of the bad guys for a little bit. And then Xavier has a super seizure that damn near destroys a good part of the strip and kills a bunch of people almost.
Yeah.
Possibly actually flat out kills them. It's hard to tell.
I don't think so. It seemed to be people seem to be getting up.
At least the people in the car, because there's a car that went crashing into another one at full speed.
Yeah. Yeah, it's... Well, and I was wondering, too, because I wasn't sure if that... It almost seemed like he had that seizure on purpose.
Yeah, like he was trying to stop everybody, like he stops time in the other movies, so maybe that.
Yeah, because he was... Well, because at that point, the bad guys had shown up at their hotel room, and I think it was... He triggered the seizure on purpose to stop them, basically, because they're coming after... The entire movie is... It's a chase movie.
Yeah, the Reavers are chasing them. Donald Pierce is the head of he's not really in it, but at least one of the guys never walks out of the back of a truck and has a gun, and you never see him from the torso down, so he looks kind of like Bonebreaker, which I thought was, again, a cool little visual nod if they weren't actually going to have a cyborg who was half tank running around the movie. Because that would have been ridiculous even for current superhero.
Yeah, that would have been very dissonant in this movie.
Yeah. So this was a nice... for the most part, they're running from the Reavers and from Xander... I already forgot his name.
I'm not remembering. Xander Rice, thank you.
Yes. Xander Rice. he really is not a memorable character, to be perfectly honest. He's your standard mad scientist. You know, but not with any of the personality. He's just sort of there. Pierce is supposed to be our main villain, I think, even though he's somewhat secondary by the end of it.
Well, I think Xander Rice didn't get in. Part of the problem was he didn't really get enough screen time.
Yeah, he was introduced about halfway through the film.
Yeah.
And we had already been following Pierce this entire time, which the actor who plays Pierce just absolutely knocked it out of the park. He's evil as hell, but he could have been irritating very easily, but he's got this sort of comforting southern drawl to him that makes him charming and pleasant, even though he is flat-out evil. He's working for Alkali Transigen is the company, and of course Alkali Lake we're referring back to, and Transigen, I believe, is from the comics, but I'm not remembering it off the top of my head.
Yeah, he's... Well, and he's clearly, you know, he's somewhat thinking, and he's, you know, he's trying to plot and plan, and there's, he has some flickers of an interesting character to him, which it also keeps you watching. I mean, yes, he's evil, but I think he thinks he's the good guy.
Oh, he's sure he's the good guy.
So which creates some interesting... Something interesting to watch on screen.
Be right back, guys.
He's really enjoyable. He's got nods to the cyborg thing. He's got a mechanical hand, which is... That was a great...
All the Reavers had cyborg hands.
Oh, fair enough.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Which
they're supposed to. They're the Reavers.
Fair enough. So, he's the only one you really see it on much, and it was a great... That was a great prop. It looked amazing. I was very impressed with what they did with that. That was clearly practical.
One of my favorite bits was when he is to fix his hand at one point, and he pops it back on, and the first thing he does is bends the fingers all the way back here, and then flips them back up again, just to check how far they can move. It's really kind of cool.
Yeah, that was really cool.
Yeah.
So, let's see.
So... The thing is, all right, so we haven't even talked about the basic plot. Basic plot is Logan is trying to earn enough money to get a boat so he can take Xavier out on this boat, essentially far away from civilization, where he can't hurt anybody anymore. And they'll just live on the ocean and, I don't know, fish for food? This was not a very well thought out plan.
I suspect it was, we're going out on the water so we can both die.
Yeah.
I think that's what the intent was. I think it was intentionally not
a very good plan.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. He's working in El Paso. Xavier's down in Mexico. Caliban is taking care of him down there. You remember Caliban from Apocalypse? Yeah, it's a different version, but it's Caliban. He's in the comics, he's one of the Morlocks. He's Callisto's second-in-command. And basically, he's a living Cerebro. He can find other mutants. He's a tracker.
Yeah.
So when... at one point, basically, a woman shows up and asks Logan to take this little girl, who is the first mutant to show up in 25 years, to North Dakota, to a place called Eden, where she'll be brought over the Canadian border and, you know, live happily ever after, presumably. Logan doesn't want to do this, but when the woman, Gabriella, who asks this, dies, and Xavier kind of pushes him into it, and the two of them, plus the little girl, go running off to try to get her to North Dakota.
Because, of course, the bad guys show up at that point, and they kind of have to.
Yeah, the bad guys take Caliban and sort of force him to track the three of them so that they could track down, you know, Laura, and try to figure out a way to use her for their own purposes, because that's what the bad guys do.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, because in their minds, she's their property.
Yeah, they see... There's a lot of scenes that are really, really a bit ham-fisted in the sense of the bad guys saying, don't think of them as children, think of them as property and copyrights.
And patents.
Patents, that would, yeah.
Yeah.
Think of them as collections of patents. I'm like, all right, guys, just roll it back a little bit. Roll it back. You were doing so good on the subtlety. Let's just, you got this.
Yeah. Yeah, the villains are acting like comic book villains. Like...
Yeah, they're acting like comic villains, I will say that much. As in comedy. Pierce definitely has some interest to him, but for the most part, yeah, most of the villains are just... We're villains. We make things difficult for the protagonist, and that's about it.
Oh, and should mention, talking about, since we are in the spoiler section, it's left very ambiguous. There's a couple of things they suggest, nothing's ever confirmed. I can't be certain exactly what happened to kill most of the mutants, because at one point, Dr. Rice makes some comment about engineering food and beverages that would kill mutants.
Yeah.
So it sounds like that might have been a factor, but also at a point, Xavier is sorrowful and makes a claim, like, it seems like he did it.
Xavier, from what I can tell, Xavier had a seizure and killed the X-Men, but not all mutants.
Okay.
Because they talked about the Westchester incident.
Okay, true.
That was similar to what happened when Xavier used his powers in Las Vegas.
Right.
So I'm guessing he lost control, he had a seizure, and it ended up killing everybody but Logan. In the comics, it's Wolverine who kills everybody because Mysterio tricks him into thinking that all of his friends were instead villains. The whole premise of Old Man Logan is all the Red Skull gets all of the villains to attack everybody in a coordinated fashion all at once, and therefore takes over the world because, you know, like, there are 12 villains for every hero.
That sounds suspiciously like the plot of wanted.
Yeah, doesn't it? Mark Millar has... I was actually saying this about David Goyer earlier, but I think it applies here too. Mark Millar has about 4 plots, and he just continues to rejigger them a little bit each time. It does sound a lot like the plot of Wanted, doesn't it?
Which, I've both read the comic book and I watched the movie.
We'll cover it here at one point.
Yeah, just suffice to say, I hated the comic book.
About as much as I hated the Secret Service as compared to Kingsman.
Yeah, hate, and I adore that movie. It's silly, it's not great, I get it. I adore it, I don't care. Give me shade, I don't care.
Yeah.
Anyway.
This is another example, I think, of how Mark Millar's work is just better taken as the seed of a good idea from somebody, and taken by a director and made into something worthwhile.
Yeah.
Because I'm Wanted, Kingsman...
Kick-Ass
2, what else?
Secret Service.
Kingsman, you did. Civil War,
yeah.
Civil War, yeah. This, I cannot think of a single movie based on a Millar book that is not leaps and bounds better. It's not actually pretty good in and of itself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wanted is the worst of them, and it's still a pretty good film.
Yeah, yeah. And it actually, we are in the spoiler section. Yeah. Basically, right after Xavier confesses this, this is the first you see of X-24.
Yeah.
And he kills him.
Yep. And the thing is that Xavier, the entire movie up in this point, has been... calling Logan a failure and a disappointment. And it's somewhat heartbreaking to watch Xavier, even sometimes playfully, but still you can see how much it affects Logan because Jackman's such a good actor.
Yeah.
And Jackman tries to save him and fails to save him. And even then, his last words are not some, no, you were really my favorite. No, you were really good at this. You're still a hero. No, it was just him... repeating, I think it was to take care of Laura.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was just him repeating to take care of Laura. So, essentially, the closest thing that Logan has to a father figure, this man who he has gone to incredible lengths to protect and to help, he dies with Logan thinking that he was disappointed in him. Yeah. And for all we know, as people, he is. As viewers, he is. It's sad and it's heartbreaking. And the movie doesn't linger on it, but it sticks with you. There's no post-credit sequence to this, but I just kind of wanted to sit there and mull on everything that I saw, even though there was nothing to specifically make me want to watch those credits.
Well, and you can't really trust... Through most of the movie, it seems to be that... while this medication that they're giving Xavier is helping the seizures, it seems to be exacerbating the dementia.
Yeah.
And so you can't be sure most of the time exactly how much Xavier's even aware of.
Yeah.
And so it who knows whether that's actually what he meant. Saying those things to Logan.
Yeah.
Or if he even knew... Because there's points right... The first scene with the two of them... Xavier doesn't seem to know who Wolverine is. And so it's very ambiguous about... You can't trust how...
Yeah, Xavier is an unreliable narrator to his own thoughts.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't trust... It does seem like he's very disappointed in Wolverine, but you can't really be sure because you can't really trust anything he says.
Yeah, but that also means that Logan can't be sure. And his natural tendency to be down on himself and to assume the worst of himself means that he will almost certainly default to the idea that Xavier is being genuine... and really does think that he's a failure and a disappointment and could have been so much more than he really is. you know, Xavier is echoing his own insecurities in this.
Yeah.
If X-23 is the shadow of his rage, or X-24, I mean, is the shadow of his rage, then Xavier is the shadow of his doubt.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
And
X-23 is his hope for the future.
Yeah. Laura.
Yes. Laura is his hope for the future.
It really struck me because that I've had relatives that had dementia, and it's rough. Well, for that matter, we both have.
Yeah, we both have, yeah.
And it's...
It's tough.
And that struck me as very, very real, because that's possibly one of the cruelest diseases ever, dementia and Alzheimer's, because it's... The person is physically present, but not mentally.
It's stolen them from you.
And it to have to be the person to sit and watch that as someone who loves them.
It is tough to do, and it's tough to watch in this film.
Yeah.
Keep in mind also that when Xavier dies, he is the last of a series of deaths. At basically, they decided to stop and help somebody on the road, this family on the road.
Yeah.
And that family, you know, took them in and let them have dinner there and put them up for the night.
Yeah.
And, yeah, they all die.
Yeah.
X-24 kills them all.
Yeah.
Every single one of them. You know, every time it looks like Logan, something positive is happening for Logan or for the people around him, that gets taken away from him every time. He is not allowed to be happy or to be content with his actions because he needs to believe, because it just reinforces the idea that being around people gets them killed.
Yeah.
That, you know, it is a tough watch. I keep going back to that, but it is.
Yeah. This is a really, that family was very good, and they had, you know, you don't get a ton of screen time with them, but they're very...
Yeah. The movie does a good job of developing them in such a way that you think they're going to live because they seem important.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, it takes the time, as long as our trio of Xavier, Laura, and Logan are at this house, let's just develop these side characters here.
Yeah.
Oh, we're gonna kill them? Oh, well, now you know who they were. Guess that hurts even more, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And particularly the father of this family, Logan fights X-24, ends up impaling him on some sort of farm machinery, and the father shows up with a shotgun and shoots X-24 until he stops moving, and then turns on Logan, pulls the trigger, is out of ammunition... Yeah. And dies.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know how you beat that.
Yeah. It's...
He can't even... Logan isn't even allowed to think, well, at least they know that I'm the good guy.
Yeah. Well, and the way it was very cleverly done, because the way you very first see X-24 is... He's come into the room, their guest room, where Xavier and Laura are staying. And he's come in through, so it's dark room. He comes in from the hallway, which is, the hallway's lit. And so he's backlit. So you think it's Wolverine. And Xavier thinks it's Wolverine. And he comes up to him, and you as the audience think it's Wolverine. And he comes up to Xavier, and Xavier, this is when he makes this confession about him killing the X-Men. And then, boom, not Wolverine, has stabbed him in the chest. And it takes several seconds before you fully process and realize that this wasn't Wolverine.
Yeah, it took me a while. My first thought was, what is Wolverine doing?
Yes.
And then it sort of occurred to me slowly.
Yeah, well, and so I think the assumption, I think the family made, the dad made the assumption that that Wolverine, of course, he had seen that there were two of them.
I think it was literally, you brought this on my family.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't matter what his actual thinking was just before he died. The point is that he died hating Logan, and Logan knows it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Which, it's a gut punch. No question.
At one point in the film, and we're just jumping around here, we're not doing this in any sort of order. At one point in the film, it turns out that in this universe, X-Men comics exist.
Yeah.
The specific ones that they had were made up for as props for this. They weren't actual issues. But they reference other ones. That's why I thought I had read them before.
Because
I remember an X-Men comic with Sauron on the front, like that one.
Oh, okay.
But no, it was a different one.
Oh, okay.
This one does not exist. But yeah, the X-Men comics exist, and the Wolverine exists as a character in these comics. Mm-hmm. But basically, Logan is at a bar, which I think is another reference to Old Man Logan, in the sense that the bar looks almost exactly like a bar in Old Man Logan called Millar's that Hawkeye and Logan stop at. And there's a shot that looks a lot like one of the comic panels in there that I just thought was really cool. But when he's in there, he's reading through one of the comics, and it has a set of GPS coordinates on it, which are the exact GPS coordinates that they're supposed to be going to in North Dakota, where Eden is. So, fairly early in the film, he thinks that there's not actually an Eden. So they're driving, but they're not really driving anywhere, as far as he's concerned.
Yeah.
He later finds out that they went there and they created this place.
Yeah.
It's not the same, but basically all of the mutant kids from the, I guess, Next Weapon X program, the transigen program.
That Laura was a part of.
Yeah. All these other mutant kids that they created all made their way there, and they're trying to get across the border to Canada. They're talking to somebody on a radio. You never find out who it is. I'm going to say it's Alpha Flight. And that the reason why Transigen is so desperately trying to keep them from getting to Canada is because they know that if they cross the Canadian border, then they have to fight Alpha Flight.
Yeah, good as of an explanation as any, because
Alpha Flight's not going to cross into the U.S. border because they're an official team, and that would be an act of war by Canada on the U.S. But you know, once they're there, Transigen would have to fight Alpha Flight. That's what I'm going to go with.
Yeah, because I did wonder about this. He, in the movie, when we were watching this, because Transigen was like, don't let him get across the border. I'm like, you're a clearly evil international corporation. Why on earth would the U.S.-Canada border mean anything to you? So, sure. That makes a good explanation.
Yeah, that's as good an explanation as any, I think.
Yeah.
But, yeah, basically the entire third act of the movie is them at Eden with all these kids. Richter, who's straight out of the comic, is the leader there, and he's really good. I like him.
Mm-hmm.
All these kids were actually really good for child actors.
Yeah.
The one electric kid in the... I looked this up, but it occurred to me that he is from the DNA of Dominic Monaghan's character from Origins, Christopher something. It was in the files. The guy who had the electric lights, he was part of, he was part of Task Force X, or not Task Force, that was dumb. He was part of the thing with Wade at the beginning, and then he was at the, he was at the carnival.
It's been a long time since I saw...
That guy right there, he's right between us. He's right there.
Oh, that guy. Oh, him. Okay, him. Yeah, that guy.
Right there.
That guy. Okay. Right. It's been a long time since I watched that movie, and I've blocked most of that movie out of my mind.
Fair enough, I respect that.
But cool connection.
There aren't a whole lot of connections to the other films in this.
Yeah.
So it's nice to see when they show up. Yeah. A lot of noble sacrifice throughout the film.
Yes.
Caliban ends up sacrificing himself, blowing himself up to take out some of the bad guys.
Yeah. Beware the light.
Yep. And I think that's kind of the majority of what I wanted to cover. I think the ending is really the only bit that I really want to say more about, unless you've got more to talk about.
No, that's pretty much it. Yeah, definitely. I think we do need to talk about the ending.
Okay. So, even if this were in the spoiler section, even if you haven't seen it yet, I think it's fairly safe to assume that, yes, Logan dies at the end of this. He has kind of one last hurrah of being Wolverine and ends up sacrificing himself to fight X-24. Laura ends up putting the adamantium bullet through X-24's head, which you see his brain splatter on screen.
Yeah.
But at that point, X-24 had already impaled Logan on a tree stump.
Yeah. Yeah. That last fight was probably the most brutal and the most visceral of any in the movie. And they were
all... Any of the movies, really.
Yeah.
Any of the X-Men movies, yeah.
That last fight was just absolutely painful to watch.
Yeah. But it was so good. It was really well choreographed. Yeah. All the kids are basically running for the Canadian border through this pass through the mountains and the woods. Yeah. And the Reavers are coming after them. And they're fighting back, but there's only so much they can do.
Yeah.
And basically, Laura goes to try to save Wolverine, whose healing factor is shot at this point.
Yeah. Well, you see, there are several shots of him, you know, his usual tank top, and you know, so you can see a fair amount of his chest, and you can see, you know, his shoulders, and he's, at this point, he's covered in scars.
Yeah.
There's burn marks. Something burned him at some point. So, clearly, you can tell, it's obvious from the beginning of the movie that his healing factor isn't working.
Yeah.
There's a really painful scene near the beginning where he goes to shoot out his claws from one hand, and one of them didn't quite... It took me a second to figure out what he was doing.
Yeah.
But it seemed to be that the claw didn't extend all the way it should. And so he's taking the other hand and pulling on it, which... Oh my god! I can't even imagine how much that had to have hurt.
Yeah. And I was watching, I'm like, dude, just grab it like this. Grab and pull.
Yeah.
You don't need... But he's Wolverine, and he's so used to hurting himself that he just grabbed it by the blade and comes away, and it's covered in blood, and his hand's covered in blood, so he has to wrap it up.
Yeah, yeah, it was... So, yeah, the point being, yes, the adamantium poisoning is killing him, it's destroying his healing factor, and, yeah, by the end of things, yeah, he's impaled on a tree stump, and he's not coming back from this. This is not...
Yeah, and Laura refers to him as Daddy, which a lesser actress in a lesser movie, that would have been so cliched and so awful, but it wasn't. It was emotional as hell, and I loved it.
And which she had never done in the movie up to that point.
Yeah, and his last words are, "So that's what this feels like," and you're not sure whether he's talking about being a father or dying, because he's experiencing both for the first time. But he seems at peace for kind of the first time, I think, in any of these movies. And again, Jackman just knocks it out of the park.
Yeah.
Playing this simple, simple role.
And her reaction, like he said, her reaction is heartrending.
Yeah.
You know, she's crying, she's not hysterical, but she's just almost emotionally shot.
Yeah.
And the perfect cap on the movie, and the thing that is so hopeful, as I mentioned, that this movie still ends very, very hopefully, is the cap on the movie is that these kids, at least a good chunk of them, do make it safely to Canada, including Laura. Well, they seem to be. They seem to be. I mean, their pursuit has been removed.
Yes, but you know, something could happen along the way. We don't know. And that's one thing that I actually rather like about it, is that it has that ambiguity to it. They just walk off, hopefully to get to Canada.
Well, they were, I mean, it seemed like they were just about to the border.
Fair. they said it was an 8-mile hike.
8-mile hike, and the sun, he had said they were going to leave, Richter had said they were going to leave right at dawn, and it was probably, I want to say, about 10 o'clock in the morning by the time Wolverine woke up.
Yeah.
So they were more than halfway there. I think they were, it seemed like they were very, very close to the border. Fair.
But it does have that sense of hope.
Yeah.
Basically, at the very end, Laura and the rest of them bury Wolverine, and she doesn't have a whole lot of experience with the outside world and doesn't know what to say, so she gives the speech from the end of Shane. Which ends with, now go tell your mom there are no more guns in the valley.
Yeah.
And it's important, I think, that this last scene takes place in a valley, in a mountain, you know, in a valley, in a mountain here. There are no more guns in the valley. There's no more threats at this point. And, you know, it's got a cross at the grave, and as everybody else walks away, she stops, pulls up the cross, and turns it so it's an X and puts it down again. And, you know, it's not because he was an X-Man. It's because he always had been an X-Man.
Yeah.
And that's why I think that, you know, what I was saying earlier, that the movie is about how heroism is something that is inside of us.
Yeah.
It's not a choice that we make. It is who we are. Even when he was refusing to help a little girl because he didn't want to get involved in her problems, he was still doing so for heroic reasons, in the sense that he wanted to take care of Xavier, and this would, you know, put a hindrance to that.
Yeah, that final scene was perfect.
It was. It's the best scene in an X-Men movie, I think, that we have ever had.
One of. I don't know if I'd say the best, but it's definitely...
Yeah.
It's definitely up there.
It's beautifully done, and essentially, it's a great way to cap off Logan's story. He's a man who was made to be a weapon, became a hero because that's who he is, was kicked around by life, and in the end was rewarded with a legacy.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, his heroism gets to continue in the person of Laura. He gets to keep fighting the fight while also being granted the peace that he so desperately deserves.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful ending to a wonderful movie and a wonderful character arc.
Yeah.
You know, 3 to 6 movie character arc at this point. I'm not sure how we want to call it.
Yeah. It's... And for God's sake, Hollywood, don't replicate this, please. Please don't replicate this.
Don't take the wrong lesson from this. The lesson is you can let really creative people do interesting things with stuff that comes from the comic book medium. The lesson is not we need more blood and gore and R-rated stuff in a movie about superheroes.
Yeah. Yeah, the main reason that this works partially, yes, because Jackman and Stewart and
Keane
are amazing actors. That's one of the reasons, but this also works because we have 20 years of history with these characters.
Yeah, we know who these people are. I grew up with Hugh Jackman as Wolverine in many important ways. Basically, he's been Wolverine for my entire adult life.
This movie would not have worked if we did not have that history.
Yeah. X-Men worked for me when I was, you know, when I was 17 years old, because that's the movie for a 17-year-old.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
this movie is the movie for a 34-year-old. And I'm glad that I got to take that journey with Jackman. And I'm glad that he's walking away from it now. Because A, he's as good an actor as he is getting old.
Yeah.
But B, I think this movie proves that Wolverine's story is done. We have told that story.
Yeah.
And there are so many good X-Men stories we could be telling. We're starting to tell Deadpool's story. And you know what? There's a lot of there's a lot to work with there. There's a lot to Deadpool. We could, you know, from there, Cable has a great story. Storm. Oh, I would love a Storm film.
Storm and Apocalypse was great.
Yeah.
She didn't get a ton of screen time, but, like, if they took that character and developed it, or that version of the character and developed it, that could be great.
Yeah, and I'm going to say something here, and if this upsets you in any way, express your dislike by giving a thumbs up below. see what I did there? How about a Cyclops movie? How about... Cyclops is not a terrible character. Sorry, Gail Simone, he's not the worst. he's been given short shrift because he seems so boring, but he's not boring. Or he doesn't have to be boring. I would love to see a movie, you know, post Jean Grey's death with Cyclops and Emma Frost. And I loved when I believe this was in Astonishing on Joss Whedon's run in Astonishing, where you're seeing the two of them, and Emma Frost knows that Scott does not love her. Scott's in love with Jean, even though she's dead. But Frost stays with Scott anyway because she loves him. And Scott is dealing with this loss and trying to deal with it in a way that doesn't hurt everybody around him. And there's a lot to mine there. You could do some really good stuff with that. You could do some stuff with a beast-focused movie. Give us more Nightcrawler. There are so many great X-Men characters. It doesn't have to be Wolverine.
Hell, do a Quicksilver movie.
Yeah.
Evan Peters is Quicksilver. I want more of that.
Yes. Yes, do that.
American Horror Story is very beloved of my heart. And he's one of the best things in it. He's amazing.
Yeah. And do Evan Peters in Days of Future Past, not Evan Peters in Apocalypse?
Yes.
Because, you know, yes. That was again, Hollywood missing the point.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, you could do a lot with a Quicksilver movie.
Yeah.
Even this Quicksilver movie.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so there are a lot of options there. But now that Wolverine is done, let's let him go. Let's move on with our lives.
Please.
And try not to do this movie again. Do another interesting film character piece using comic book elements to strengthen that character piece rather than having to lean on them.
Yeah. Please. Gods of Hollywood, I will make any sacrifice. Please.
We have a black goat someplace, I'm sure.
We can find one.
We can find a black goat.
Or we can sacrifice a copy of The Witch.
There we go. That's close enough.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which, also, great movie. If you haven't seen it.
Yeah.
Awesome. Yeah. Anyway.
So I think in the end, what we're trying to say is see Logan.
Hell yes.
Yeah. All right. Well, I've been Garu.
And I've been Debbie.
And this has been Cinematically Ours.